Greetings to everyone today. Welcome to St. Gabriel's Church, and a very good morning to everyone. Happy Chinese New Year to all who celebrate, and also welcome back for those who are traveling. 2022 seemed like yesterday. With the New Year and Chinese New Year celebration, many of us have yet or just about to settle down, to prepare ourselves for the challenges and also the opportunities that the New Year has to offer. Let us put our hope and trust in the Lord. Let us delight in His statutes and His word, so that our hearts are truly fixed on the true joy of knowing God is with us, just like how He had carried us through 2022. With this in mind, let us remember that this is the day that the Lord has made to come together in worship and in praises to our mighty God. So can we all worship Him with gladness and thanksgiving? Can I hear a yes? Good. Good. Everyone is awake. Good. So before we start, okay, let us offer our prayer to God, a short prayer before we start our worship this morning. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, give your people your grace to love you just as you loved us. Thank you, God, for your kindness, your mercy, and your unfailing love. Bless us, Lord, as we bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen. We shall have the opening hymn. Let us all rise.
With many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns, for music bar its own. Awake my soul and sing, all pain who died for thee. King through all eternity. Crown Him the Lord of life, who triumphed over grave and rose victorious in the strife for those He came to save. His glory shall we sing, who died and now lives in realms of light, where saints with angels sing your songs before Him day and night, your God Redeemer King. Found in the Lord of heaven, and thrown in words above, of love, crown Him with many crowns, as thrones before Him fall. Crown Him, ye kings, with many crowns, for He is King of all. Crown Him, ye kings, with many crowns, for He is is Lord of all.
Collect of purity, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Collect of the day. Almighty God, who alone can bring order to the unruly wills and passions of sinful humanity, give your people grace so to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that among the many changes of this world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Call to repentance. Seek good, not evil. Overcome evil with good. Repent and turn to God. Let us take a moment to repent of our sins and selfishness and seek God's grace to overcome our shortcomings. General Confession. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought, word, and deed. Through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Shall we all rise for the peace? My peace I give you, let not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Now may the peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us offer to one another a sign of peace.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord,
one more time,
has made. This is the day,
This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say it's the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Yes, he has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Yes, he has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Yes, he has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Yes, I rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Amen. Hallelujah. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul, and the testimony of the Lord is true, making wise so simple. This is a very old song, but it's a very, with a very meaningful words to each and every one of us. Let this word just speak to our hearts as we sing this song together. The Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, much fine gold, sweeter also than the statues of the Lord is right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. More to be
true and righteous. Holy Communion this Sunday. Let us prepare ourselves as we come before Him to accept His blood and His body. Let us be cleansed before Him. Hear our prayer. We are Your children and we gathered here today. We've gathered here to pray. Hear our cry.
Hear our cry.
Lord, we need Your mercy and we need Your grace today. Hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Our Father, hear us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Hear our song,
hear our song,
as He rises to heaven, may Your glory fill the air. As the waters cover the sea,
see our heart,
and remove anything that is standing in Your way of coming to You today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Oh, our Father, hear us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Our Father, hear us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Though we offer you this money, who have crossed that river before, this is the song we'll be singing forever. Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Though we are few, we're surrounded by many. We have crossed every river before. This is the song we'll be singing forever. Holy is the Lord. 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 Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, Father, hear us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. From heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father, hear us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Forgive our sins, we pray. Forgive our sins, we pray. Yes, forgive our sins, we pray. Dancing my soul, my Savior God, to thee how great thou art, how great thou art. Thou saved my soul, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Thou saved my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Savior God, to thee,
grave thou wast. How great thou art.
Let us take a moment to pray and to intercede for one another. Thank you, God, how great thou art. For Lord, we can never understand the grace, the magnitude of your grace for each and every one of us here today. We are so grateful that, Lord, that you are in our midst, that when more than one gather together, you promise us that you will be in our midst. And as you hear our prayer, O Lord, Father, may you bless this prayer, this intercession. Help us to put our hearts right before you. Help us to set our priorities right for the new year. Thank you, God, for the Chinese New Year that allow us to gather with our family members and friends. Thank you for the safe journey of going back and coming back. Help us to be ready for this year. And as we start the year together, for those who are working, give them strength and motivation. Let their work be a testimony of your power and grace. For those of us who are studying in school and university, grant our children the motivation, keen hearts to learn and to grow. Bless the paths of their lives, that they will do well and will remember your goodness. For those who have retired, keep their lives active in both minds and spirit. Let them cherish the moments of your many blessings to them, that they will continue to desire your presence evermore. For those who are struggling emotionally and in physical health, let them find peace and comfort from you. Let them know that you are their rock and salvation. Hear their prayers, O Lord. Heal their sickness. And be ever present, O Lord, in their journey. For our church, help and teach us, O Lord, how to serve you. Give us the wisdom to know your plans and will, and to follow through with our hearts of commitment and conviction. Father, we want to remember Pastor Joshua, Deaconess Wunping, Pastor Peter, and Reverend Wong, the PCC members, the ministry leaders and workers, that you may renew their strength, inspire each one to serve you humbly and faithfully. Help us not to give up. Allow us to focus on the goal, the perfecter of our faith, the purpose of our life. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us all pray the prayer for St. Gabriel's Church. God, our gracious Heavenly Father, may you pour your Holy Spirit upon our hearts and bless the mission and ministry of St. Gabriel's. Assist us to faithfully and sincerely love one another. Care for the poor and helpless, and witness your saving love to all. Give us grace to be the servant of others, as Jesus was the servant of all. We ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We shall now have the ministry of the word. The first reading will be read by Yahweh on Isaiah chapter 58, verse 1 to 9. Second reading will be read by Veron Sue, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 to 12. And the gospel reading will be read by me, Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 to 20.
The first reading, taken from Isaiah 58, beginning from verse 1 and finishes at verse 9. Shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decision and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast? A day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your near guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with a pointing finger and malicious talk. This is the word of the Lord.
The second reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom, as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks.
Thank you, Veron. We shall all rise on the gospel reading, taken from Matthew chapter 15, chapter 5, verse 13 to 20. Glory to Christ our Savior. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Verse 17, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of God. We shall now have the message by Pastor.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you. Bless us, Lord, this morning as we share this time and ponder upon your words together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Very good morning to all of you. Today, the topic is salt, light, too much or not enough. In life, either you have too much or you have not enough. So to strike the balance, just nice, will be difficult. But that is the aims of our spirituality. And I suppose that is what we need to do in our life. Just in right proportion, in moderation. So Jesus tells us, in the context of the Beatitudes, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So ultimately, I suppose what Jesus wants them to do is, whatever they do, they preach or live their life, ultimately is to be able for them to bring the blessings of God in their life and ultimately to glorify the Father in heaven. That is the ultimate aim, all right? So in the context of Beatitudes that we read just now, Jesus spells out the standard of holiness expected of those whose life are meant to be conformed to his. So in the Beatitudes, Jesus speaks of the promise to those who belongs to Him, the rewards of following Him, the happiness, and that they will be greatly blessed. Right, so following Jesus is actually a blessing, and blessing that Jesus talks about will be theirs, provided that they follow the criteria. Right. So now today we hear that what follows in the mouth of the Sermon on the Mount, and it talks about this particular context, it talks about salt and light. And so here Jesus makes very clear to those who are listening to him of their vocation, of their task, of the responsibility of those who live according to the principle of the kingdom of God, the Beatitudes. So the blessings that are promised by Jesus are to be spread throughout the whole world, and of course to the whole of humanity, and through his disciples, those specially chosen by him, but also for those who will be just normal followers. And I suppose when you look at the context, it's entirely in accordance with the way God has acted throughout salvation history. Now think of how in the Old Testament, God's blessing came originally through one man, Noah. It did not come through the big empire, just Noah. And there are very great tribes around them, but he chose this person, Noah, together with his family. Then he bring blessing to the world. And then, of course, we heard about Abraham, that through faith, he was recognized as righteous. And later, when they begin to form a nation, and then through the children of Israel, and even through this particular tribe of Judah. Who were they, these people, the tribe of Israel, Judah, who were among all the many nations of the earth? And remember, they are nomad, traveling from one place to another. Certainly, they are nothing glorious, nothing great like all those big civilizations with settled settlement, with great armies, with all those great things surrounding them. They are just a nomad people traveling around, like the gypsies, all right? But God chose these people. And God reaches out to the many through these very few. So it was with Jesus, virtually an unknown personnel. Only in the Bible that we find a particular concentration on person of Jesus. Other than that, the name itself is very common. Right? So Jesus, the gospel story tells us that he gathers himself with just 12 disciples, a very small group. Then he speaks to a crowd of insignificant nobodies on a hillside in a remote Roman province. Today we heard about Israel. In early days, just a remote place, nobody really think about it. Rome and consider all those big cities. And who are the people that he was talking to? And in the hillside, not in the auditorium, not in the stadium, like Billy Graham Crusade, and certainly not the church like that, it's so nice. Certainly not in a big synagogue that he can gather all the people and all those influential people. In the hillside, who want to go to a hillside? Who want to go to a church that is built in a hillside where you have to travel through all this track road? And yet, Jesus spoke the very important significance of the kingdom values to these people. Well, looking at all those things, who are we in the world that is, you know, beyond us? Actually, if you look at the context where Jesus spoke about and, you know, people that become significant, or rather God works through them, actually nothing and nobody, if you also put ourselves in that context. The smaller you are, the more insignificant you will feel. The first church I was in was in Epiphany Church. In normal Sunday, you get 20 people, you're lucky, you know. You feel that, enough people. So whenever you go for a pastor fellowship meeting, and in that road, you look at Jalan Gambut, you have the Methodist Church, which is definitely at least 10 to 20 times the size of that church. Then you have Roman Catholic Church. So when you go for a pastor's meeting, then you go there. Then interestingly, you know, when people talk about your church, how many members in a church? And then, only 20 people, you look down. You know, that's how you will behave, how you feel in comparison. But of course, nobody really kind of looks down on you, but just how you feel, right? Small, small place. But if you look at the Bible, small does not mean ineffective or inconsequential or insignificant. right? It's just how you feel, but God works through small things. And definitely, if you were to look at the context, or maybe in your own church here, you will feel very away, hidden somewhere in a place in Sungai Besi. Probably you will not be thinking about Petaling Jaya, you know. Think of, even compared to St. Paul's, you think that you are much smaller, right? Today I passed through that, wow, the cars are parking outside. Huh? Wow, that's a look like a big place. And you go to an even bigger place, other churches, even bigger. And you do feel small when you pass through and you think about yourself. But that is where I think great things happen. When you have the confidence that you are doing what necessary, then you know that you're on the right track. So small doesn't mean insignificance or inconsequential. Great things can happen. So I'll tell you a little story now of the crossing the Red Sea. I don't know whether you heard of this story, right? No, you know how the Red Sea was crossed, right? Moses was there with a stick, right? And God commanded him and he hit the water, you know, and it's supposed to split. And then the Israelite crossed the Red Sea in front of the pursuing Egyptian army. And when Moses commanded them to cross the Red Sea, nobody dared to cross. Nobody did anything, right? No, someone has to do something, right? And just a story, I think it just illustrated my point. Then suddenly someone jumped into the sea, the raging sea, and the sea parted. And the Israelite crossed, managed to cross safely on the other side. And the rest, you know his story. And then after crossing, Moses said, wow, I want to know who is the person with great faith who actually jumped into the water and then parted the Red Sea. Although I have, you know, the rod with me, but it still takes the cooperation of people to trust in that. And this person dragged this person out and said, this person is the great person, great faith, jumped into the water and then parted the Red Sea. Just one person. And Moses asked him, wow, man, wow, you're a great. How did you find such great faith to jump to the water and then everybody was safe, be able to cross across? And the person say, I just want to ask one question. Who pushed me into the water? Oh, just to illustrate something, sometime, you know, you may think you're small, but even God will use us. So by baptism, you may be one, but you are the child of God. And the Bible says that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and we have been made one with Jesus in his body and blood. So today we believe that Jesus, God, entrusted to us tremendous power to do good and to be his blessing. We who are inheritance of the kingdom of God, we are called to share actively in living kingdom value and making the kingdom present, true, and welcoming in our midst. So wherever you are, I think that is our main mission and trust. To a blessing in a community. And Jesus tells the people who are listening to him, and they know that they're insignificant, and the disciples know that they're insignificant in comparison to all those religious leaders. But he tells them something very important too. And here he uses the imagery of the salt and light. So you are the salt of the earth, he tells the people. And we can understand something about this metaphor, the salt. And those days when you talk about salt, you know, a soldier in the Roman army was sometimes paid with salt instead of money. And salt is a very valuable commodity, all right? Salt is being used as a medium of exchange. And their monthly allowance was called salarium. So I find this salmi being the Latin word for salt. So this Latin root can be recognized in the French word salaire, which eventually moved into English language and we call it salary. So the background is the Latin word salarium, right? Salt. Huh? So today we receive salary is something important we cannot live without. And we know that a little bit of salt, and the people who hear it will understand, is important because it gives flavor to a large amount of otherwise tasteless food. Salt has the quality of preserving meat, your salty vegetable, right? You preserve it, huh? You're going to dish a salted egg, right? You can keep for quite a long time because it preserves whatever is preserving from contamination. And used appropriately, and salt also purifies and cleanses. So it's not just about food, it's about some qualities that enhances life. And you look at the Old Testament, in the Old Testament law, a little salt was added to the sacrifices, whether animal or cereal. Huh? In Leviticus chapter 2, verse 13, it says, "Season all your grain offerings with salt to remind you of God's eternal covenant. And never forget to add salt to your grain offering." I just wonder, why do they need salt to do that? It's to purify the things that they are given. And the problem is things are not burned immediately. And things have to be fresh, so they preserve it. And salt will enable it to be enhanced, to preserve it, and to burn better. Ezekiel chapter 43, verse 24 says, "You are to present yourself, or present them to the Lord. And the priests are to sprinkle salt on them and offer them as a burnt offering to the Lord." So salt kind of plays a very important part in the act of sacrifice. Of course, in the New Testament, Colossians 4, 6 tells us, "Your speech must always be with grace, as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how you should respond to each person." So it's comparing your speech to be seasoned with salt. Oh, that's interesting imagery. And James chapter 3 verse tells us that, "Brothers and sisters, this should not be so, because out of the same mouth come praising and cursing. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brother, can a fig tree grow olives, or the grapevine bears fruits? Figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water." So the very salt has a ability to tell us what is good, what is not, right? But in the context here, you find that it's talking about the people being the flavor, right? Enhancing, preserving what is good and what is proper. And the other imagery he used, the metaphor was, "You are the salt, the light of the world." So the light, just like salt, does not exist on its own for its own sake, because we don't eat salt for dinner, right? We put salt into the chicken or whatever dish and make it better. And neither do we look at light directly. This light is meant to lighten up everything. It's meant for a purpose of enhancing and giving us vision to the things that we have around us. So just imagine, you know, you have spotlights all over. We don't look at a spotlight, neither do we see the sun, because it is not meant to be so. Light and salt are meant to affect others. So the light and salt of Jesus is about us. And Jesus says in St. John Gospel chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." You are the light of the world, but Jesus is the light of the world. So we are not the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world. You are meant to shine forth the light. And Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, and there he says he is a reflection of Christ, that he is no longer he who is living, but Christ who lives in him. So if you look at this imagery, what Jesus is telling us is that our own life may become a reflection of the life of Jesus. And so in the Beatitudes, when you use the light and salt, they're called to be a blessing to other nations, those people around them. And we can only pray that Jesus, God, would take possession of us completely and be the salt and light of this world, and so that he would dwell in us so fully that through us, his light may shine out in our world. So both the metaphors refers to our life, not just our life, but our life with added values. You know what I mean? You increase the flavor, you improve the usefulness, and you improve who you are, the basic functions of who you are. So you are human like everybody else in the world, but it's about added value to your life. And that is, I think, the Beatitude talking about. So the people who come and listen to them, to Jesus, it's not just about a chosen people, but you got to add value to your status as a chosen people, the Jews, the blessing of God that comes or followed it. But then immediately Jesus qualifies what he says. Those things are easier said than done. So he says, if salt loses its saltiness, then it is not of much use. If salt becomes tasteless, it loses its importance. If a light source is hidden or covered up in a bowl, bushel used in the other text, it's a kind of container that used for measurement. But for dynamic translation, you use bowl. That means quite a big bowl that you put your light in, inside it. Well, if you hide your light in any way, the light's as good. It is as good as not having a light at all. So those light, if you cover it up, it doesn't. It is lighting, but it doesn't serve its function. So both can lose its effectiveness. Well, you can say through carelessness, lack of knowledge, or foolhardiness. Or in confession, we say through our negligence, weakness, or deliberate fault. Right. So how can we lose our saltiness or the usefulness of light? Well, when you lose its taste, when light is being hidden. And in the confession, I think it gives us three very broad criteria. Well, we can lose our usefulness when we are negligent. That means we ignorance of what we do. Sometimes we commit sin before we don't know why it is so. Sometimes weakness, or we just fall into it. Or sometimes we know and we still do it. Okay, that's temptation. So how can we lose saltiness? Lose the effect of light when we turn aside, or what we call backslided, or become too attached to worldly values. Probably when you say we lose our love for the Lord, our devotion. And it happens along the way when people are not careful, or become separated from the community, or from the Word of God through our own fault. Right? We look for something and then further and further we drift away. What if personal conducts became to contradict what the gospel asks us to do? And then we become counter-witness. Have you heard before that, you know, a Christian by our own life, sometimes we discourage other people. Not that we are any different, it's just that they take into it. But it does happen that way. So I think that we need to be careful sometimes with the conduct of being Christian. So what if salt become too salty or light become too bright? Yes, you want to keep the saltiness, not to lose it. But sometimes it can also go the other way around when salt become too strong or light become too bright. You know, when you eat salty food, at least for me, the first problem I'll get is headache. It's too much ajinomoto, you become too thirsty. Your blood pressure goes up. Or you have too bright a light. When the spotlight is too strong, then it becomes too over-glaring. It hurts the eyes, and both are not pleasant and unwelcoming. And Jesus is telling the Pharisees, we need to avoid ways of living our life that is too aggressive or intrusive in our religious practice. Over-jealous spirituality or expression can be, well, not helpful too. And it can be difficult to live it. Too holy a people. You know, sometimes it can happen. So you need to watch out about things like that as well. So this particular incident of, I just received a book that was talking about this particular Reformed church, Reformed theology, right? And you look at all this theology, it's wonderful. And nothing there contradicts the Bible in any serious way. In fact, we subscribe to all that. But the only problem is that you become too overzealous in promoting what a particular way of religious expression. And then it become moral policing. You know what I mean? Like in this country, I think it's good that we keep religion in moderation, not to be overwhelming. Because when you do that, then religious practices can be imposing. So we need to keep that as well as us as Christians between churches too. When churches come together, we also need to be in moderation in how to consider the differences that we have, but still being able to call one another brothers and sisters and not to be separated. So when salt become too salty or light become too strong, then it's difficult to connect. And I don't think that's what Jesus wanted the people at that time to do, like the Pharisees in particular, the religious leaders at that time. They are definitely becoming too strong in their religious expression. And that's where the societies are divided. So saltiness, salt can lose its saltiness, and yet salt can also become too salty, and that's where the moderation comes in. But Jesus called us to be salt and light. So I suppose how can we be moderate in all that we do? I think one of the things that we need to think about as we look at the salt and light, first thing, to be salt and light in the world today, it calls for us to live with great courage. What does it mean, courage? To live our Christian life with steadfastness, and I like the Boys Brigade, sure and steadfast. Huh? To be courageous, you need to be sure, you need to be steadfast, right? Not to be, you know, moving around. Courage needs sturdiness. It has to be grounded. It must not be faint-hearted, nor false-hearted. Boldness in living and acting what is right. I think to exercise our faith as Christians today, anywhere in this country, it takes great courage to make the right decision and to make the bold decision, right? To stand firm and not to move around. I'm glad that we are still connected with the schools, St. Gabriel's. And many schools, you realize that they have removed the cross, right? But as much as possible, we try to retain the mission characteristic of the school, and it's becoming very difficult because to find headmasters who are Christians is very difficult now, getting less and less. And one HM just told us that there are so many places where you can't, not only you can't find Christian headmasters, you can't even find non-Muslim headmasters. So you have to put a Muslim there. Not because it's wrong or anything like that. It's just that the characteristic of the school is best, you know, handled by Christians. So how do we continue to speak out that this is a mission school? The mission characteristic of the school need to be retained, right? So I'm glad that there are people who still speak about that and to recapture the missionary spirit of the school. And this is only one side of it and one aspect of it. And it takes a lot of courage for people who are in that area to really speak out. You must thank God for the work of the Christian Federation of Malaysia, right? Representing the Christians. You may think that there are no values and it doesn't really affect us, but actually they do, right? Some policies that comes out, they have to voice out. People who are at that level have to voice out. They're not here. They are on another level to speak on the policies. And it takes courage for people like that to be in the midst of non-Christian community to speak out. And we need to pray for them and ask God to continue to give them the courage and strength. So different Christians operate on different level. Great courage is needed to be salt and light of the world. And also, call for prudence. When to speak and when to remain silent. When to act openly and when to act in secret. So we all need to know our personality. Because personality is inborn. Character can change, but personality is inborn. All of us have certain inborn characteristic. So to be effective salt and light, you need to know. Some are short-fused, you know what I mean? Some are quick to temper. That is personality. Nothing wrong. That is how it is. Some are just pensive, laid-back, like me. Okay. But some are just very quick in their reaction. Some are reactive, some are proactive. They let the flow along. Some people are very outspoken, you know what I mean? That is their personality. And of course, some are loose cannon. Just speak because that's what they think, that's how they feel. Some are more reflective. Some are go-getters. Some are just more considerate. So those are personality we need to discern between ourselves to be salt and light. And some people are very good in the sharing and witnessing. Their personality is outgoing. They speak, right? So some people are just quiet invitation. That's how they operate. You need to know how you operate, and that's how you can be effective salt and light. So we need to constantly ask for wisdom and discernment. It means that we have to strive to live consistently according to the Beatitudes. Now, how do you know you're on the right track? Whatever your personality, you can't change it. Don't force yourself in a mode that you are not. All right? Be yourself, but know your points that you're good in. Well, the Beatitudes, talks about being poor in spirit, being pure in heart, being merciful, being gentle, peacemaking, to be with and in Jesus, to be generous and honest, be truthful and be just. So if you want to know on the right track where you are, the Beatitudes is a Christian standard operating procedure for living and behavior. So always consider where you are according to the teaching of the Beatitudes. Right? If it is in line with that, you're on the right track. You cannot go wrong. Right? That is your SOP, the Beatitudes that Jesus talks about. So ultimately, I think we are all called to be salt and light in the way that will be effective in the particular context that you're in. Then Philippians chapter 1, verse 10 tells us, so that you may approve the things that are excellent in order to be sincere and blameless until the day of Christ. So Paul is encouraging the people, whatever you do, it should be in excellent. So if you're introvert or you're extrovert in that particular context, the things that you do is excellent, then you express it. And whatever you do is blameless, that people cannot pick on it and say that, well, you're living not according to yourself. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11 tells us, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life and attend to your own business and work with your hands, just as we commanded you. Right? So lead a quiet life, to attend to your own business and work with your hands. Actually, it sounds very, if you were to be a bit more crude with it, you say, don't be a busybody. So make sure that your own life shine out. Don't worry about other people. Just be what you need to be, exercising your gift, your ability in the best possible way, salt and light. Never mind if another person's cooking not so good, too salty or not enough salt, but make sure your own cooking is good enough, even for yourself. All right? So the church is like a city set on a hill. Its ultimate purpose, as I said earlier, is only to give glory to God. It exists in order to call down the blessing or to impart the blessings of Christ, of the Holy Spirit on the church and ultimately to the world. We pray that all may be safe, all may come to the knowledge of the gospel. That is all that we are here for. And that is how we are called to be effective, to be the channel and to be the light, shine the world to show where the true light comes in. And Psalm 34, verse 8 tells us, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. So I pray that we all be salt and light. May we all have just enough, right? So that the flavor come out, not too much, not too little. Ngam-ngam. I think ngam-ngam is a good word. Ngam-ngam in moderation, in all things in moderation, whether in our Christian witness or in our Christian expression or in our Christian living. Just nice. And that's where I think the challenge comes in. And may God bless all of us that we can bring people to see, to taste and see that the Lord is good, because the gospel is the way of life, the truth. And that's what we are here for. And may God bless us and as we share our life together. Let us pray. Lord, show us how to be salt worthy and how to give light. Help us to take your light where darkness abound. Teach us to give a little at first, and then all we have. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor, for the message. Let us all rise for the Nicene Creed. Let us all pray. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and the Virgin Mary and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We shall now have the tithes and offering.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're all new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're all new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Beloved, the scripture tells us that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. As we prepare ourselves for the communion, let us now recite together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness. By your manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, for you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so it is the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ suffered and died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Prayer of thanksgiving. Shall we pray together? Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of the Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We shall now have the notices.
Welcome to St. Gabriel's Church, everyone. We shall have some notices for everyone. Number one, on the annual reports of 2022, for Head of Ministries, please submit to the church office as soon as possible. In our midst, there are five people who will be celebrating their birthdays in the coming week. Vanessa Hoon, Elijah Wang, Ray Wong, Aloysius Wong, and Susan Wong. Let us pray for them. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you in our midst that we have members who are celebrating their birthdays. Father, we want to remember them that your blessings will continue to flow in their lives. Help them to remember your goodness and continue, Lord, to be salt and light for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You'll be able to find the rest of the notices in the bulletin.
There's item 7, Diocesan English Youth Camp. This month from 24th to 27th in PD, youth aged 13 to 20, you can have a look at the notice board for the details of the camp. So it's just one of the things that's going on in the diocese. Now can we all say the closing prayer, and then we shall sing the doxology. Let us rise together. Lord, let us be your salt and light in this world. Empower us by your Spirit to live in obedience and faith. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, peace, to love and serve the Lord. Name of Christ. Amen.
As we go with our week ahead, acknowledge and crown him in all our lives, in all our ways. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me. Thy matchless thing through all eternity.
crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed over the grave and rose victorious in the strife. All those who came to save, his glory now we sing. Who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. And crown him the Lord of lords, who over all doth reign, who once on earth the incarnate word for ransom sinners slain, now lives in realms of light where saints with angels sing. Their songs before him day and night, their God Redeemer King. So crown him the Lord of heaven and throne the worlds above. Crown him the King in whom 'tis given the wondrous name of love. Crown him with many crowns as thrones before him fall. Crown him, ye kings, with many crowns, for he is King of all. Crown him, ye kings, with many crowns, for he is King. Oh, one more time. Crown him, ye kings, with many crowns, for he's the King of all.